The other day I was driving and I heard Garrison Keillor on the radio in the morning. He does this lovely thing with the poetry in the morning. And he gave a quote from Henrik Ibsen, who wrote Enemy of the People, which you should read. If you haven't read that and you're interested in fluoridation, you should definitely read that. But he gave a quote from Ghosts. It's not only what we have inherited from our father and mother that walks in us. It is all sorts of dead ideas and lifeless old beliefs and so forth. They have no vitality, but they cling to us all the same, and we cannot shake them off. Whenever I take up a newspaper, I seem to see ghosts gliding between the lines. There must be ghosts all the country over, as thick as the sands of the sea. And then we are, one and all, so pitifully afraid of the light. And I would suggest to you that our professional bodies, our departments of health, our people in public health are pitifully afraid of the light, because they want to hang on to this fossilized belief system that fluoridation actually works and is good for us. So, with that as preamble, in my presentation, I will give you the four simple facts and one realization that opened my mind in 1996. This is after I read what my wife gave me. Secondly, the better ways of fighting tooth decay. The events that have made fluoridation obsolete. Estimating a safe dose of fluoride to protect children from lowered IQ. And lastly, how can we end fluoridation? The four simple facts and one realization that opened my mind in 1996. Number one, there's not a single process in the human body that needs fluoride to function properly. And I speak as my main training has been a biochemist. Not one single biological, biochemical reaction in the human body needs fluoride. It's not an essential nutrient. Sometimes the other side will say that, but it is not. And they have no evidence to back up that it is a nutrient. On the other hand, it's very clear that there are many biological processes which are interfered with by fluoride. Always given the adequate concentration, of course. That's always a caveat. But we know that fluoride inhibits enzymes, switches on G proteins, does all kinds of things. It's not something that you want in your body, if you can possibly avoid it. The single most important fact for me was this one. How extremely low the level of fluoride is in mother's milk. 0.004 parts per million. Now the other side sometimes says, oh, fluoride is everywhere, it's in all the water supplies, it's in the sea, yes, yes. Don't you realize then what a stupid thing this is? Because nature has told you that the baby does not need fluoride. Are you telling me after millions of years of evolution that every pregnant woman, every mother in the world has an inadequate supply of fluoride for her baby? That somehow that nature has screwed up on baby's first meal? I do not believe it. And I do not believe that a bunch of dentists in Chicago knows more about what the baby needs than Mother Nature herself. You know, I actually gave the chief health officer of Victoria in Australia. I said, tell me, Dr. Hill, I think it was Hill, Dr. Hill, if fluoride was good for the baby, it was important for the baby's development, teeth or anything, why is it so low in mother's milk? You know what he said? So Mother Nature has dealt some children a raw deal. What this means, of course, in practical terms, is that a bottle-fed baby in a fluoridated community like Seattle is getting between 175 and 300 times the fluoride dose that nature intended. This is the most serious thing that we're doing right now. A huge gamble was taken in 1950 when the U.S. Public Health Service endorsed fluoridation. Not only had one single trial had not been completed, but they had no idea that what fluoride would do to the baby's bones, the baby's brains, the baby's endocrine system. No idea at all. And yet they went ahead. That's a huge, reckless gamble. The government has the audacity to give us this legacy. The legacy of this practice for every single one of you here is a lifelong, up to this point, a lifelong accumulation of fluoride in your bones. And they really don't know. Again, it's another gamble. They really don't know if the levels of fluoride in your bones are going to reach the levels which they do in India and China and cause horrible symptoms. The first symptoms of fluoride's poisoning of the bones is just like arthritis, stiffness of the joints, pains in the joints, pains in the bones. And as it accumulates still further, the bones get harder and more brittle. And we still don't have anybody in the United States who's had 70, 80, 90 years of this fluoride accumulating in their bones. What we know is that 40 to 60% of the fluoride is excreted by the kidney each day, but the rest accumulates in our bones and is steadily increasing over a lifetime. The realization is simple. We should never use the public water supply to deliver medical treatment. We've never done it with any other substance, nutrient, mineral, medicine. We've never used the public water supply as a delivery system for these things. Why? Because once you put it in the water, you can't control the dose. That's absolutely essential. Everybody knows that. Every time you go to the doctor, you get a prescription. What do they tell you? Take 3 tablets a day or whatever. Secondly, you can't control who gets the medicine. It's totally indiscriminate. It goes to people with poor diet, with poor health. It goes to babies. It goes to the very old. It goes to people that already have compromised because they've got low iodine intake or they've got poor kidney function. It goes to everybody. Completely indiscriminate once you put it in the water. It violates the individual's right to informed consent to medication. Unethical. Unethical. This is well established. Go to the webpage of the American Medical Association and read about what informed consent requires. And what is happening is that Seattle right now is doing to every citizen in Seattle what a doctor in Seattle could do to no individual patient. Say, I've got some real good stuff in here, drink it, it's going to be good for you. And you say, doctor, I don't really want to do that. You say, you do it. I'm telling you, you should do it. If you put any pressure on the patient to take that, he could lose his license or she could lose her license. Absolutely preposterous. So many things are preposterous about this. When you get to the end of it, your judgment is going to be, is this guy Connett preposterous? Is he crazy? Are these other opponents of fluoridation crazy? Or has my government gone crazy? Could I possibly believe that the Center of Disease Control, the American Medical Association, the American Dental Association, the World Health Organization, all the professional bodies, the American Public Health Association, have they all got this wrong? It's preposterous. Yeah, I hope I can convince you at the end, I'm not the preposterous one. What's been going on for 68 years in this country is preposterous, and what's more, it's a massive betrayal of the public's trust. A massive betrayal of the public's trust. This is what Queensland Health said teeth look like from a fluoridated community. And this is what teeth look like without exposure to fluoridated water. That is fraud. That is fraud. What they've taken there is baby bottle tooth decay, which fluoridation can no way reduce that effect. The better ways of fighting tooth decay. The vast majority of countries do not fluoridate their water. And guess what? Here we go. 97% of Europe does not fluoridate its water. 4 of those countries fluoridate their salt, but according to the World Health Organization, tooth decay in 12-year-olds is coming down as fast in fluoridated countries as non-fluoridated countries. So here is tooth decay then coming down from, in this case, the 70s to the 2010. These countries are all fluoridated. And in these countries, they tell people, look, look at tooth decay here. Since we started fluoridation, look, the tooth decay is dramatically dropping. That's why fluoridation is so successful. Then you go to these countries, which are non-fluoridated, and the tooth decay is coming down just as fast, if not fast. A better strategy. Most of the tooth decay is concentrated in low-income families. 80% of the tooth decay in the United States occurs in about 20% of the population. And this is the population of low-income families. So they're right to target these families. They've just got the wrong strategy. Now, we need to target those families with better dental education and better diets. And they do not need to swallow a substance that could put them in greater disadvantage, because fluoride's toxic effects are made worse by poor diet, something I've already mentioned. Everyone agrees that fluoride's benefits are mainly topical. Thus, it makes much more sense to provide topical treatments, either in the form of fluoride varnishes or in the form of simply brushing with fluoridated toothpaste. Simple stuff. Better still, I would encourage the use of xylitol toothpaste. Xylitol is a natural sugar, and we produce it in our own bodies at about 15 grams a day. This sugar prevents the bacteria that cause tooth decay from sticking to a surface, and they wither away. So it's a nice bactericide, if you like, because it hurts them but doesn't hurt us. It's been used successfully in Scandinavia and Japan for many, many, many years. So in Wichita, Kansas right now, they're experimenting giving children xylitol mints, one in the morning, one in the afternoon, specifically targeting schools in low-income areas. And it's working. Now in Scotland cannot fluoridate, but the Scottish government opted in 2005 a dental plan called the Child Smile Program. And what they're doing in this program is school-based toothbrushing schemes. They teach kids how to brush their teeth in nursery schools. They're offering healthy snacks and drinks to the children. They are giving oral health advice to children and families on healthy weaning, diet, teething, and toothbrushing, annual checkups and treatment if required, and then finally, fluoride varnish applications. This is all from the Scottish government. The proportion of children aged 4 to 6 without obvious dental decay has risen from 42.3% in 1996 to 67% in 2012. And this is attributed to toothbrushing, those early lessons. The proportion of children aged 10 to 12 without obvious dental decay rose from 52.9% in 2005 to 69.4% in 2011 and 72.8% in 2013. They are way ahead of their target. Their target was like a 70%. They're over that already. And this is a very simple, very elegant program. And we're talking now low-income kids in places like Glasgow. Glasgow researchers found that the scheme had reduced the cost of treating dental disease in five-year-olds by more than half between 2001 and 2010. This is just one country in Europe. Most of Europe is not fluoridated. Before they spend another penny of money to promote this practice, we're talking about the Center of Disease Control that spends millions of taxpayers' dollars each year promoting this practice. They should take a fraction of that money, go to Europe, and find what they're doing in Europe to fight tooth decay successfully without forcing fluoride in everybody's drinking water. That would be a good use of taxpayers' money. In short, our kids need more brushing, more fruit and vegetables, less sugar. Less sugar means less tooth decay and less obesity. Less obesity means less diabetes, fewer heart attacks. In other words, education to promote less sugar is very good investment. If not, you put the two campaigns together, fight tooth decay, fight obesity in the same stroke. yank those soft drinks out of schools and do everything we can to educate parents to cut down on the sugar crap that they get all day long. We need education, not fluoridation, to fight tooth decay and obesity. Part three, the events that have made fluoridation obsolete. There are quite a number of them, some more serious than others. Event one, but starting in 1982, appeared in a number of leading journals like Science and Nature, articles which indicated that tooth decay was no different in fluoridated and non-fluoridated communities. And these articles, Leverett in Science in 82, Cahoon, 84, 85, 87, his work was done in New Zealand, Dissendorf in Australia in Nature of 1986, Gray in Canada. All these articles look at, strangely, finding the little difference in tooth decay between those communities with or without fluoridation. And then if you like, to put this matter to rest, the National Institute of Dental Research, which is a big promoter of fluoridation, big research body, spends a huge amount of money researching fluoridation on teeth. They did a massive survey, 86 to 87. They looked at 39,000 children in 84 communities. And it was finally published in 1990 by Brunel and Carlos, both of who worked for the NIDR. And what they did is that they looked at decayed, missing, and filled permanent tooth surfaces, a measure which we call DMFS. In this study, they found on average, for children 5 to 17, the average tooth decay, as measured by decayed, missing, and filled surfaces, was 2.8 surfaces in the fluoridated communities. This is children who always lived in a fluoridated community. And here, the children always lived in a non-fluoridated community, 3.4. Take 2.8 from 3.4, and you've got 0.6. So the saving that they found in this massive study cost the taxpayers nearly $4 million to do this massive survey. All they could come up with was a saving of 0.6 of one tooth surface in a child's mouth out of 128 tooth surfaces. That's what all the angst is about. When we start to hear about the risks, go back to this and see whether you think saving on average 0.6 of a tooth surface could possibly justify some of the risks I'm going to be talking about. But I should add one more thing. Not only is this 0.6, in my view, miserably small, but it wasn't even shown to be statistically significant. And Kathleen Thiessen a couple of years ago looked at the statistics and found it wasn't statistically significant. Incredible. Now, that was a US government-funded study, and this is another US government study. The first one was one of the biggest studies. This second one is a small study, but very precise. This was part of the Iowa study, where they've been tracking children from birth, following a whole bunch of parameters on children from birth. And they decided to use the data here to calculate what was the level of fluoride that a kid needed to swallow in order to reduce tooth decay. So in this study, what they did was for each child on an individual basis, calculate, estimate how much fluoride they were taking in each day, ingesting each day from toothpaste, from fluoridated water, from food, based upon the levels of fluoride in the food. And what they found was no clear relationship, no clear relationship between the amount of fluoride that the kids were swallowing and tooth decay. In their own words, these findings suggest that achieving a caries-free status may have relatively little to do with fluoride intake. That, again, should have shaken the faith of those who promote fluoridation, but it's just gone by, like everything else. The claim that swallowing fluoride lowers tooth decay is still unproven. After 68 years, there's never been a randomized control trial, an RCT, which is the gold standard for epidemiology, to demonstrate effectiveness. Not been done. Incredibly. When you think of all the millions and millions of taxpayers' dollars that has been spent on this, and all those assurances that it's effective, they cannot back that up with the gold standard of epidemiology and show us a randomized control study. Instead, we are left with grade B studies, second-rate studies, and that the reason they're grade B is there's so many parameters, there are so many different parameters that affect tooth decay, that to actually match two communities exactly, except for the amount of fluoride they're getting in the water, is practically impossible to control for all these variables. There's so many variables which affect tooth decay. So the evidence is pretty weak. Now, the second event probably explains everything I've said up to this point on event one. Those studies, which didn't find a difference in fluoridated, non-fluoridated, the World Health Organization data, which shows no difference in kids between fluoridated and non-fluoridated countries, and the Brunel and Carla study, and the Warren study. All of these can be explained by this next event. In 1999, the Center of Disease Control, the big promoter of fluoridation in the United States, conceded that the predominant benefit of fluoride was topical, not systemic. And let's have a look at the exact quote so that you know what we're looking at here. This is the big promoter of fluoridation, the Center of Disease Control, Oral Health Division. Fluoride carries preventive properties initially were attributed to changes in enamel during tooth development. This is why pediatricians gave fluoride tablets to pregnant women. This is why they gave drops to babies, all in the hope that the fluoride in the enamel will build up in the teeth under the gums so that when they erupted into the oral cavity, they would be more resistant to acid attack from the bacteria breaking down sugar. That was the mechanism that was believed for 50 years. And then they said, whoops, we're sorry. Laboratory and epidemiologic research suggests that fluoride prevents dental caries predominantly after eruption of the tooth into the mouth, and its actions primarily are topical. Now, if fluoride works primarily on the outside of the tooth and not from inside the body, why swallow fluoride and expose every tissue of the body to a toxic substance when you can brush it on your teeth and spit it out, if you want it? I don't. But if you did, brush it on your teeth and spit it out. This way, you not only protect yourself against fluoride's toxic effects, but you also solve the ethical problem. Because if you use that as your strategy, then you're not forcing it on people that don't want it, which is so unacceptable to many people. There are a large number of people out there who say, I don't care if fluoride works. I don't care if it's dangerous. I don't want the government telling me that I have to put this substance in my body when I don't want to put it in my body. That's where that's one single argument. Well, you can get around that argument tomorrow. In 1999, then, fluoridation should have ended. Right there, when the number one promoter of fluoridation admitted it worked topically and not systemically, or predominantly topically, that's when they should have changed their strategy to the one now being used in Scotland. But they didn't. Why not? Event number three, in 2006, the US National Research Council published its three-year review. The remarkable thing about this review was that the panel chosen to look at the toxicology of fluoride in water and examine EPA's safe drinking water standards was the first balanced panel ever selected in the United States to look at anything to do with fluoride. They had three pro-fluoridation, three anti-fluoridation, and six who had not declared their position publicly. They expected to get this report out in 1 year, but it took them 3 years. There it is, fluoride in drinking water, a scientific review of EPA standards. You can get this online and search it for free. They showed in this review, and they didn't look at fluoridation per se, Their task was to look at fluoride toxicology with little attention to the dosage involved. They looked at animal studies, they looked at biochemical studies, they looked at clinical trials, they looked at human studies. And what they found is that fluoride causes many health problems. That's not the argument. The argument is whether fluoridation causes any health problems. Or the way I'd like to frame it is this. Is there an adequate margin of safety from the levels which we know causing harm in India and China and other places with high natural levels? Is there an adequate margin of safety to protect not the average person, but all our citizens from that effect, drinking fluoridated water? That was the key question. They did not address that in this report. They just delineated what fluoride was capable of doing. Now, on the day this was released, I remember this, I was in Italy at the time, on the day this released, the American Dental Association claimed that the NRC only looked at levels of fluoride between 2 and 4 parts per million, which was not relevant to water fluoridation at 0.7 to 1.2 parts per million. I'll come back to that in a second. 6 days later, the Oral Health Division of the CDC said more or less the same thing. The findings of the NRC report are consistent with CDC's assessment that water is safe and healthy at the levels used for water fluoridation. And then 1 year later, the National Health and Medical Research Council in Australia brushed aside these findings and said, the NAS report refers to the adverse health effects of fluoride, and the reader is alerted to the fact that fluoridation of Australia's drinking water occurs in the range of 0.6 to 1.1 milligrams per litre. With that having been said, they completely ignore the 500 pages of this report. Incredible. These statements by the ADA, CDC, and NHMRC indicate three things. One, they don't know the difference between concentration and dose. It's a self-serving argument which they use again and again and again. They say, show me the study that's been done at 0.7, 0.8, or 1 part per million, which has caused harm. And wink, wink, nudge, nudge, they know very well that they're not doing this, these studies at the levels of fluoride in the drinking water in Australia, in New Zealand, in Ireland, in Canada, in the United States. So that in itself is a self-fulfilling prophecy. They know they don't have many epidemiological studies. But this confusing of concentration and dose is inexcusable, because if you had two populations, one drinking 1 part per million and one drinking 2 parts per million, even 4 parts per million, the dose would overlap. The doses by experience by these some of the individuals in these two populations. In other words, a high water consumer at the 1 part per million will be getting a higher dose in milligrams per day than a low water consumer in the higher concentration. And so to dismiss this on the basis of comparing concentrations is self-serving scientific poppycock. They have little notion of the basics of regulatory toxicology. You can't simply just declare safety before you've done a careful risk assessment to calculate whether you've got an adequate margin of safety. And I will be doing that a little bit later on the IQ studies. They didn't do that. No risk assessment was performed by either of these, any of these three agencies. And thirdly, seriously, the ADA, CDC, and NHMRC can't read. If they're saying that this report shows that this report is not relevant to water fluoridation, they can't read, because Chapter 2 in that review was an exposure analysis where they carefully calculated how much the kids and people in the population were getting exposed to fluoride. And what they concluded, the NRC, was that at 1 part per million, there were subsets of the American population who were exceeding the EPA's safe reference dose for fluoride. How can you possibly say that this is not relevant to water fluoridation when these people have shown that some people are getting more than the recommended safe reference dose, the 0.06 milligrams of fluoride per kilogram body weight per day. And for those who can't read, there's a little diagram. Here's the diagram. On the bottom axis there are different age ranges going across. And there's the line. The red line is the reference dose, the EPA safe reference dosage. The thing I've circled is bottle-fed infants. Bottle-fed infants are getting way over the safe reference dose for fluoride. How can you say that this is not relevant to water fluoridation? So I put to you, these statements from the ADA, CDC, and NHMRC are political, not scientific statements. They are more intent on protecting the fluoridation program than they are to protecting our children, our residents, our citizens. They are working backwards. Whenever any evidence comes through that there's a problem, then they junk that evidence. They're working backwards because this program, for some reason, is more important to them than telling the truth, informing the public, protecting our health. The propaganda used by public health officials. This is the thing which upsets me more than anything. I see absolutely no justification for a civil servant, somebody who's paid by the taxpayer, to spin, massage, or even lie to the public. That's just unacceptable. There are public relations agencies which will do that for any organization, any industry. But it shouldn't start with the civil servants. Maybe the politicians can spin and massage. They are in charge of policy, but they should be fed accurate, objective information, and that is not happening with the public health service in this country and public health agencies in the various fluoridating countries around the world. Event four, in 2010, the CDC again published dental fluorosis figures that confirm that American kids are being hugely overexposed to fluoride. And to put this into context, the early promoters of fluoridation made it quite clear that at one part per million, 10% of the kids would have very mild dental fluorosis. What does that look like? 10%. They said this wouldn't be recognized by anybody but a dentist. This is the one extreme range of dental fluorosis, the worst of very mild, okay? But at the other end, what you would see are white cusps on the edge of the teeth. It's symmetrical. And, okay, so that's what they thought. The 10% of kids would have this, or something like it, and that was justified, that this was the trade-off for reducing the kids' tooth decay. So what did the CDC report in 2010? They reported that 41% of all American children, that's both living in fluoridated and non-fluoridated communities, had dental fluorosis. And not all of it in the very mild. You see the very mild there? 28.5%, not 10%, 28.5%. But look at that, 8.6% mild. Mild is up to 50% of the enamel impacted on the affected teeth. And moderate or severe, 3.6%, that's 100% of the enamel impacted. We could argue about whether this is a health effect, whether it causes psychological damage for kids who don't want to go on a date. They don't want their partner to, their potential date to see their teeth because they realize they're lazy, slob, because they don't look after their teeth, blah, blah. Whatever, the psychological damage to a teenager having either this condition or this condition would have is, you know, that's up for discussion. But I don't want to go there. I want to go to this, which to me is the key question. When fluoride is damaging the baby's growing tooth cells, causing this condition, dental fluorosis, and this is by a biochemical mechanism, this is an internal mechanism, it is a systemic effect, not like the benefit, which is largely topical, this comes from inside the body. What's it doing to other developing tissues? And that's a question that was not addressed comprehensively, satisfactorily, before all these professional bodies, following in her master's footsteps, the US Public Health Service endorsed fluoridation in 1950. So, event five, since 1991, extensive evidence has emerged that fluoride damages the brains of both animals and humans. And I do mean extensive. There's a huge weight of evidence on our side which is not counteracted by the proponents. Over 40 animal studies shows that fluoride damages animal brain. 19 animal studies shows that fluoride interferes with the animal's learning ability, memory. They dose the animals fluoride and show they perform less well in mazes and, you know, all the little tasks they set animals, well established. 12 studies which shows neurobehavioral deficits. 3 human studies which shows that fluoride damages the fetal brain. And lastly, 38 out of 44 published studies indicate that fluoride is associated with lowering of IQ. And then Zhang, and I'm particularly fond of this IQ studies because Zhang controlled for a lot of those confounding variables, which they claim he didn't, but he did. And I'm interested because I went to the villages in China where these studies took place. These villages had a very stable population for hundreds of years, the same occupations, rural farmers, same housing conditions, same diet, same lifestyle, same schooling, everything that you think of was the same in these villages. And Zhang also controlled for lead exposure and iodine intake, and he's just published another paper to show that as far as arsenic was concerned, there were higher levels of arsenic in the low fluoride village than the high fluoride village. So arsenic was not a confounding factor. What he found was a drop of 5 to 10 IQ points across the whole age range, and the whole IQ curve was shifted over. The black line is the low fluoride village, less than 0.7 parts per million. The magenta line, the village between 2.5 and 4.5 parts per million. And the estimated threshold at which this lowering occurs is 1.8 parts per million, according to Zhang, 1.8 parts per million. Now, the Harvard Review. Many of these studies have been published in out-of-the-way Chinese journals. Fan has spent a lot of money getting many of these IQ studies translated. They used some of our translations here. And some of the others have been published in the journal Fluoride, which it completely ignore. But anyway, Choi and Grandjean and a couple of others did a meta-analysis on 27 of these studies. They could do that because the methodology was more or less the same, comparing the IQ of children in the high fluoride village with the low fluoride village. In a couple of cases, it was fluoride from coal burning, but in most of the cases, it was from fluoride in the water. The study was published in Environmental Health Perspectives, which is one of the leading environmental health journals in the world. They acknowledge what nearly everybody has said about these studies, is that we would all like more information about what they did. These are often short articles, and we would want to make sure that they controlled for all the confounding variables. So there are weaknesses in these studies. And just as there are weaknesses in the studies which purport to show that fluoridation works. But nevertheless, what they also concluded, that the results, these were done in different parts of China, in India, in Mexico, and Iran. So many different places these were done. And out of those 27 studies, 26 of them found the same result, a lowering of IQ in the high fluoride village. It's remarkable to get such consistency in something where your studies are distributed over a large geographical area. And the average lowering of IQ in these 26 studies was 7 IQ points, which is substantial, as you'll see in a moment. Now, the promoters claim that you can ignore these studies because the concentrations used in the Hyfroid villages were too high. The concentrations, remember the same thing again, comparing concentrations, not bothering to calculate the dose, but comparing concentrations, they said they're very high. And most of the proponents have referred to two of the studies which were as high as 11 parts per million. What they failed to point out is the other 25 studies were less than 10 parts per million, and 9 of the studies were less than 3 parts per million in the high fluoride village. And that less than 3 parts per million does not give you an adequate margin of safety to protect all our kids drinking water between 0.7 and 1.2, which I shall demonstrate in a moment. But as I've already stressed, comparing concentrations is simplistic and self-serving. What is needed is a margin of safety analysis, which I shall now do. Now, the goal is to estimate a safe dose of fluoride which we could confidently predict, based upon these studies, would protect all children in a large population from lowered IQ. This is a standard procedure that the EPA has to do whenever it's looking at the toxicity of a substance and protecting the population. Remember, our task is not to protect the average person, but to protect the most vulnerable. The overall goal is to find what we call the no observable adverse effect level and divide by a margin of safety of 10 to protect the whole population. So that's what we're aiming for. Now, we start here. We will start this margin of safety study with the lowest concentration where lowered IQ harm was found. Well, here are 5 of the studies in the CHOI review. This is their table, or part of it. And these were all statistically significant. You can see all the drops of IQ there. And those are the levels of fluoride in the high fluoride village, 1.82, 2.9, 2.5, 2.38. Now, to be conservative, we will deal with the lowest of those villages, which was 1.8, but that's a concentration, milligrams per liter. We've got to calculate a dose. Well, we don't know what the dose is. So the best we can do is to calculate a range. Let's make some assumptions about how much water we think those kids might be drinking. So let's assume the kids were drinking 1 liter of water a day. Then the dose would be 1.8 milligrams per day. If it's 1.8 milligrams per liter, you drink 1 liter, you get 1.8 milligrams. That's the dose, right? And then a child who drank half a liter of water a day, what would he get? 0.9. Half a liter at 1.8 per liter is 0.9 milligrams per day. What about a kid that drank 2 liters of water a day? His dose or her dose would be 3.6 milligrams per day. So we got a range, a reasonable range, I think, from half a liter a day to 2 liters of water a day. And that's 0.9 to 3.6. Again, we have to be conservative. Let's take the lowest end of that range and say this is our lowest observable adverse effect level, is 0.9 milligrams per day. However, if you don't have the NOEL, which is what we're aiming for, we've got to divide that by 10. So you divide the low L by 10 to get to the no L. And 0.9 divided by 10 is 0.09 milligrams per day, the no observable adverse effect level. So now we're going to step 4, applying a safety margin of 10 to protect the whole population, including the most vulnerable. We divide the no L by 10, and now our safe level to protect all our kids from having a lowered IQ is 0.009 milligrams per day. Let's calculate how much water a kid could drink then at 1 part per million if the safe dose is 0.009 milligrams per day. He or she could only drink 0.009 liters a day, which is 9 milliliters, which is 2 teaspoons of water. In other words, if that study in China at 1.8 parts per million is a valid study, normal procedures would say that a kid in the United States shouldn't drink more than 2 teaspoons of fluoridated water. Okay, so some of you might be concerned about all these safety factors. Believe you me, that's what they use. But let's lift one of the safety factors. If we drop one safety factor of 10, children shouldn't drink more than 90 milliliters of this water. That's less than a glass of water. Half a glass of water. All right, let's drop another factor of 10. They shouldn't drink more than 900 milliliters of water. That's less than a liter. So any way you cut it, once you've got these studies showing lowering of IQ at these concentrations, there is no margin of safety to protect all our kids from having their mental development impaired by drinking fluoridated water. And that's particularly true of bottle-fed infants at the very beginning when their brains are developing, the last time, the last point in time that they should be exposed to fluoride. And by the way, I could take this a little step further and calculate the dose that a bottle-fed baby would get and a breastfed baby would get. And what comes out based upon these same numbers is that a breastfed baby is just about at the safe level. So mother's milk protects our babies from fluoride. So if you do live in a fluoridated community, please breastfeed, not bottle feed your baby, if you can possibly do it. If you're forced to bottle feed, then get mineral water or spring water, or not tap water. But of course, if you're a low-income family, you can't afford that. So when they say that we got to fluoridate for low-income families, baloney! The babies that you least want to get fluoridated water are babies from low-income families. They already have many strikes against them. They probably already have potentially lowered IQ for all kinds of reasons. But most importantly, they have a potential of having a poor diet, and poor diet exacerbates fluoride's toxicity, well established. Low proteins, low calcium, low vitamins. Zhang has published a study which shows that the lowered IQ relates to the plasma fluoride levels. This is the level of fluoride in the blood before it goes into the brain, just before. And you can see with all his data points, there is a decrease in children's IQ as the fluoride levels in the serum goes up. So it's these measures of individual exposure which further strengthen our conclusions here. Now, this is what Philip Grandjean said, author of this CHOI analysis. He has also just published a book called Only One Chance about chemicals which damage the brain. He said, fluoride seems to fit in with lead, mercury, and other poisons that cause chemical brain drain. That's his expression, chemical brain drain. The effect of each toxicant may seem small, but the combined damage on a population scale can be serious, especially because the brain power of the next generation is crucial to all of us. And now I want to use a series of pictures to illustrate what he's getting at here. And incidentally, he's used these same pictures, I better draw on the mind, in a videotape that's available on the web, so you can look at his explanation. But basically, IQ follows a normal distribution curve, the bell-shaped curve. The bell, the heart of the bell is the average. Most people have an average. If you're looking at height, weight, or in this case, IQ, most people will be around the average value. But look at the two tails of this bell-shaped curve. And the green, the area under the curve, that's the number of kids above an IQ of about 130. Those kids are very bright or geniuses. So if you look at the green area as a fraction of the total area under that curve, that's the fraction of kids in any population which is going to be very bright, going to be genius level. Okay? You want to get to geniuses, maybe you need to push it out a little bit further, a bit smaller. Now at this end of the curve, the magenta is the that area under the curve is the fraction of the population which is mentally handicapped. Now, if you were to shift downwards by 5 IQ points, the average would drop from 100 to 95. A school teacher would not be able to distinguish between two pupils in the class, one with an IQ of 100, one with an IQ of 95. So we wouldn't notice this. Unless we were doing careful studies, we wouldn't notice that this is happening. But look what this shift does to the two tails. It halves the number of geniuses in your society, and it doubles the number of mentally handicapped. And I don't think I need to say much to convince you that this would have huge social ramifications and economic ramifications for an industrialized society like the United States, competing in a global economy. If you halve the number of geniuses in your society, you halve the potential to get your Gates and people like that, and you also double the number of children that are going to need social services for the rest of their lives, and all the other social implications. So I think it's clear that once you know that a chemical used in daily lives has this potential of shifting the IQ downwards, how much proof do you need before you say, oh my God, stop it? Now, if this was a chemical byproduct from some process that we were really keen on, supposing it was a contaminant from Silicon Valley, where they're making all these computers which we want so desperately, you'd know it would be tough, wouldn't it? Tough to say, here's something that's an incredible boon to the economy, but we've got to stop using it because it might be lowering the IQ of our children. But what if it's something that we are deliberately adding to the drinking water? How much do you need before you turn off the tap? How much more information do you need than 200 or 300 animal and human studies to turn off that tap? Where are the doctors in this country? Where are the people in education in this country? Where are the public health authorities in this country if they can't see that? That's why you should be getting angry. That's why you should be getting organized and bash these heads of these civil servants of yours and your counselors to stop this foolish practice. Thank you. They asked Cesar Chavez, the great workers union leader, Cesar Chavez, Cesar, how do you organize? He said, one person at a time. But Cesar, tell us, how do you organize? One person at a time. It's got to be one open mind at a time, leading to one community at a time. Effecting change is like driving a nail through a piece of wood. The expert can sharpen the nail. To effect change, you need the hammer of public opinion. That's the teamwork here. I and people like Bill Osmondson and other experts, we can sharpen the nail, but now you have to take the hammer and drive those nails home. Well, first of all, we've got plenty of resources. You've got the NRC report, which is the Bible of toxicology on this subject. You've got our book. You've got our webpage, 50 Reasons to Oppose Water Fluoridation, which is available online from our webpage, fluoridealert.org. You've got a 29-minute video, Professional Perspectives on Fluoridation. That's 15 scientists articulating this. People have produced this DVD in hundreds. Go to the webpage, download it. If you can't download, get somebody under 12. They'll be able to do it for you. Download it, make umpteen copies, and get it to everybody that you can think of, especially your dentists and doctors. There's my son made this one, 10 Facts on Fluoride, which goes with a booklet. And my son also has just put up the study tracker. If you're a researcher, you've got access now to the most fantastic database on fluoride toxicity from anywhere in the world. And this hasn't come from the millions of dollars spent by the CDC or the ADA. They put all their money into propaganda. It's the citizens who've made available the science on this subject, including translating umpteen studies in Chinese, Russian, and others. Many citizens, media, and decision makers have little idea of the number and caliber of the people fighting fluoridation around the world. I can tell you, I have had the privilege of going to communities all over Australia, all over New Zealand, all over Canada, all over the United States, all over Ireland, and several places in England. I've been to Israel and I've been to Japan on this issue. And I can tell you, there are dozens and dozens of communities. And those people are fighting fluoridation, not to make money, not to get power. They come to the meetings, they're working their tails off, often using a lot of their own money. Why? For their kids, for their grandchildren, and for their communities. So I've had the privilege of working with some of the best people in the world, both fighting incineration and fighting fluoridation. There's little difference from what I see this end. It's exciting, but it's invisible. I see it, but most of you do not see it. Most of you see this as a marginalized group struggling, battering your heads against the local brick walls and the local councillors, etc., the local health department. You see it as an impossible task. That's why we are making this visible. We need to make it visible, and we need to bring all the groups and communities fighting fluoridation together and form one alliance. And that alliance is the Worldwide Alliance to End Fluoridation. And I'm happy to tell you that this organization was one of the earliest groups to join that alliance. So this is what we got to do. In each of our communities, we are vastly outnumbered. Around the world, we have a formidable number of people supported by a formidable amount of scientific intelligence. But the world doesn't know that yet. We've got a lot of education to do. That's it.